Hey everyone, John here and welcome back to another Sapphire tutorial. Sapphire Shake is a very popular effect for creating shaky text looks, and by itself it's terrific, but when you use it in conjunction with Sapphire Effect Builder, you can get much more complex, interesting looks. So in this two-part tutorial series, we're going to explore two looks that I've been developing. One which is a little more subtle, just adding a touch of glitchiness, which is the one we're going to focus on today. And in the next tutorial, we'll look at one which is a bit more extreme, which is more of a glitchy reveal. And both of these looks take advantage of the Twitch setting inside of Sapphire's Shake Effect. So download the project file and let's take a look. So this look is mostly developed, but there are a few things that we could do to refine it and also to save it as a preset. So let's go into our effect controls. And you can see it's made up of shake, color, parallax strips 1 and 2, layer, and shake 2. So we'll click on edit effect, and that will open up Sapphire Effect Builder. And let's just walk through this. So we'll start actually with the source, okay? Because the source obviously is the text. And I'll just click on preview selected node. And that way we can preview only the node or up to the node that we've selected. Clicking on shake 1, if we just drag the time indicator, you can see we're getting a little bit of shake there. There's not a lot of shake going on, and that's by design. I really wanted this to be just the occasional twitch, okay? And Sapphire Shake has the twitchy style setting, which was perfect for the look that I wanted. So that's giving us that touch of twitch, but obviously by itself like this, it's just not enough. Now, beneath that, we have Shake 2. So I literally selected this node, right-clicked, and chose Duplicate. And for number 2, you can see it's exactly the same because it was duplicated, but the amplitude is slightly different. So on 1, I've got 0.167, and on 2, I've got 0.222. But other than that, they're exactly the same. The big difference here is, though, I'm using a mask. So before we have a look at that, let's take a look at the mask. So the mask's base is just a white solid. On top of that, I have parallax strips, something I use a lot. And just the key things to point out here, you can see it's very fine. And that's because the relative height is very low. It's just 0.001. And another thing to notice is that strip speed is set to 0. Okay, so there's no motion. And that's piped into the Sapphire layer effect into the foreground with the mode set to screen. Now we can already see the other one there. So that's this one. So that's again parallax strips. And once again, no strip speed. And you can see I've just created slightly bigger blocks for this one. One thing to also point out that's very important with both of these is that show is set to strips over black. Okay? So it gives me this sort of black and white matte look. So combined, as we just saw, we get this look. So that is being piped into the mask port for Shake 2. And I just want to point out one more thing with Shake 2 I just remembered. Under channels, I've set my RGB randomness to 0.2. And that's going to give us a touch of channel splitting. So if we have a look, if I could just find a twitchy frame somewhere, there we go. Something a little bit more than that, maybe back at the beginning here, there we go. I'll just preview it and we'll see. Ah, there we go, there's a frame there. A little bit harder to sort of zero in on a frame because we have the twitchy setting. So now we've got the shake shaking everything, so the entire text. But we've got the second shake only shaking what's being matted, or you're only seeing what's shaking through the mat. So we get that look, which is really nice. And you can see a little bit of that separation. I can just find that frame again. Just a touch of separation there. We can just get a little bit. Obviously, you could increase that quite dramatically. And you're going to get a lot of separation, which is nice as well. But I like just a little bit to add a little bit of color. So overall, it's a pretty basic look, right? So I think what we can do is we can explore how to make this a little more detailed and also how to set this up so we can save it as a preset. Now, I definitely want to come over and, you know, make sure that I only view the parameters I want to see in the host that are most useful. And I also want to link a few parameters. But before we do that, I actually want to adjust the look a little bit by adding some more effects into our mat. We've got our strips one and our strips two. Let's start with strips two. And with that selected, if I just hit tab and type in pixel sort, so I want pixel sort, I'm going to drop that in there. And look, that just adds the terrific pixel sort look. And if we come over to shake two, and just find a frame that shows us some twitchiness. What I might do just for now is actually come over here and just choose normal. And that way we're going to see a lot more twitchiness, okay? So we don't have to search for a frame. So now you can see we're getting that pixel sort look introduced into the look as well, which is really nice. So if I just select that, I can play around with that. Maybe if I'll turn off previous selected node. And I can do things like, you know, reverse the sort direction. So I get it shooting to the left. And, you know, decrease the threshold so we get a lot more all over the text. So you've got great control. This is why I love Sapphire Effect Builder. It makes experimentation easy and you can really get some complex looks very simply. So you can play around with different settings here. I just wanted to show you that you can drop that in. And I'm going to leave it like that. Obviously, this can also have a mat if you wanted to give it a mat as well. All right, so now let's try this. I was experimenting earlier. So with parallax strips, let's add the grid effect. Type in grid and hit enter. So that's probably going to be way too big. So what I'll do is I'll load a preset. And I'm thinking I want to create a new preset for this as well, because I did create a simple grid preset, which you can access as well. But I think I want it even finer. So I'm going to click load. That's still a little too big. I'm going to create a much finer one. Maybe make this 260. And I'll make this 200. I want to make them fairly square. It doesn't necessarily matter. 210. No, so probably want to make that lower. So maybe 180 or 160. Something like that. So a little squarer. And we'll bring the grid opacity right down. Something like that. So now if we come back to shake, and we want to be on shake two. See, when it shakes, it reveals that grid as well, which is really interesting, right? And like I said, if I wanted to have that only appear in certain areas, I could add a mask to this. So if I just hit tab and type in shape, I could use any effect for this, or almost any effect. Just disconnect that and drop that into the grid. So now I've masked that out, right? I mean, you probably don't want a star. Maybe we want to have something like, a triangle. Now we've only got that there, right? And if we select that, we're only going to see that in that part. And that can be animated, of course. So don't forget that effects have this mask port because it can be very useful. Now, I just use grid and pixel sort because I thought they look cool, but I recommend spending a few minutes now, try different Sapphire effects and see what you can come up with. And what we're going to do after that is we're going to prepare this for output. Okay, so hopefully you've had a chance to have a bit of a play with that. Yours may or may not look exactly the same depending on what effects you've decided to use. I'm actually going to save this as a preset for the next version of Sapphire, so I'm going to leave this as it is. But it needs a bit of work in order to make it as useful as it can be when working in the host. Now, the first thing we need to do is just click on Shake 2 again and just make sure that's set to Twitchy, because it does change the settings a little bit. You can see it's slightly different there. So what I want to do, because remember previously I mentioned that I duplicated this shake, and I actually want these to be in register. You could have these quite different. You could have a much huger amplitude on this one. You know, you could change all of the settings for each one and make it quite crazy. But I want to keep it in register and keep it a little more simple and controlled. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make all of the parameters that control the amount of shakiness, these ones here, I'm going to make these drivers for Twitch for shake one and have them drive shake two. So to do that, I'll click on the stopwatch for amplitude and just choose make driver. Okay, so I'm going to do that for each one of these. Click and make driver. Just like that. We'll do these all while I'm still recording because it's pretty easy. Obviously, you could go ahead and do all of them, but I don't necessarily want to do all of them. I do want to do the seed, though, so that the seeds are identical. And this one here has no RGB randomness. I'm going to leave that as it is. I'm going to have that separate. I'm not touching any of these other settings. So I'll come down to shake two. And I'm just wondering, do I want the amplitude to be separate? I could, of course, create a link and I could add a bit of math to that to have them slightly different each time, or slightly more than the shake one, or slightly less. But I might actually not link amplitude. So what I'll do is I'll just turn that off. Click shake two, click on frequency, click on the stopwatch. This time click the link, not make driver. And under select driver, choose frequency. So shake one frequency. So that's now linked. You can see it grays out there. So it's controlled by shake one. I'll just do one more. So click on the stopwatch, click on the link, select driver, and this is phase. And that's now linked. So I'll just pause for a moment and I'll just do these other two. Okay, so they're all connected now. So that's all controlled by shake one. So if I wanted to have, you know, way more Twitch frequency, for example, take that way up, there's a whole lot of shaking going on like that, right? But see how it's all moving together? That's all happening together in sync. And that's the look that I wanted. I'm going to just undo that. Bring that down to two because I want this to be nice and subtle. All right, so they're linked, okay? Now, is there anything else we can link? Let's come over to parallax strips. I was thinking before that one thing that actually looks quite good with this is changing the angle. If I take that angle to something like that and come over and click on my... Okay, we're actually off previous selected nodes, so we should be able to see the result of that. Here we go. So now we have that at an angle. But notice how parallax strips 2 is not at an angle. And that may be the look that you want. But I think that I will actually link these together. So parallax strips 1, angle will be the driver. Make driver. And parallax strips 2, angle will be what gets driven. That's parallax strips 1, angle. Aha, so now we have it at an angle, right? Very nice. You could also, you know, link the grid to that if you wanted the grid to be at an angle as well. So that's definitely up to you. Maybe pixel sort. So let's try that. We'll go and parallax strip angle. Nice, so now the pixel sort is also at the same angle. I actually sort of prefer that look. It looks a bit weird if some things are shooting off at different angles. That's a nice look, right? And of course, at any time, you could go in and you can increase the amount of parallax strips on either one or the other. I think I would keep these separate because I'd want to have, you know, a bit of control over how much parallax strips I had, you know, size, all that kind of thing. That's obviously way too big now. But I'd have to sort of play around with that. There you go. So it's up to you to decide which parameters you want to link and which ones you want to keep separate, depending on the look that you're after. I'm going to just undo a couple of times, come back to parallax strips one, and just change my angle to 0. And everything updates. Very nice. Bring that back to 2 and shake 2 updates, which is great. Now, just one other final thing I want to connect is the seed. With the random seed connected, it means that if I change one random seed for one effect, it will change the seed for all the others. So it's a really quick way to create variations of the parameters that you've set up. Now, since we've already set up shake 1 and seed is a driver, let's use that to drive the other seeds. So parallax strips 1 is first. Come down to seed, click the stopwatch, click on the link, and choose shake 1 seed. So I'll do that for number 2 as well. Stopwatch, link, and seed, and pixel sort. Stopwatch and link, and seed. I think that's all because we've already linked shake 1, that's seed. So now all of the seeds that we have in this setup will be driven by shake 1 seed, which just allows us to create more variations. So with all that set up, now we want to consider how to set this up so that there's less parameters in the host. We only want to see the most useful parameters in the host. And it's really important that we get this set up correctly before we start keyframing in the host. Because if we come back and we turn on visible host parameters or turn them off, then we're going to remove our keyframes, which is not ideal. So let's go. Color, we don't need to see in the host. Parallax strips, I'm going to turn everything off by clicking at the top here. And, you know, there's so many different parameters. Angles, probably definitely one we want to change. We could, you know, we can make it as adjustable inside the host as we want by making these parameters visible. But the whole point is that we really want to consider things that allow us to create variations and things that we want to keyframe. Otherwise, you know, if we start adding everything in there and make it fully adjustable in the host, it just becomes, you know, uncontrollably unusable. So let's just keep it really simple. So we're already controlling angle with number 1, so that's grayed out anyway. So I'll turn all of those off. And grid 1, possibly we'd want to play around with the grid box size. So just select that. Pixel sort, let's turn everything off. We've got sort, angle, and seed already sorted out. I like the reverse. I thought that was quite good. So we'll turn that on and maybe threshold to give us more or less. Layer, we don't need to see. Just turn that off. And shake 1, turn it all off. We want, let's see, amplitude, frequency, just these ones that are green, and seed. You may or may not want motion blur. And here we'll turn off all of 2, but the only thing we'll add into that is channels and RGB randomness. Okay, so that's basically everything. And we could save that as a preset here, but what I like to do is go back into the host and I like to just check to make sure that I haven't missed anything. So under shake 1, we have everything, good. Parallax strips, just angle. There's my grid. There's my pixel sort. And there's my shake. So nice and simple. So a nice custom effect, which allows us to focus only on the things we know we want to change for this look. I could always save this as another version and go inside of the builder, turn other things on, and then I could focus on different parts of this. So it's pretty flexible. So with that done, I can just click on save preset and, you know, give it a name, give it a description, and whatever characteristics, whatever tags, and save it. And of course, you can use that with any host that supports Builder. I'm going to just probably do a few more little adjustments before I save this for the next version of Sapphire. All right, so hopefully you found that useful. We'll be looking at Twitch inside Sapphire Shake again in the next tutorial when we look at a more extreme look. To learn more about Sapphire, visit borisfx.com, where you can also download a free trial. For now, this is John. I'll see you in the next tutorial.